for help. So when we see the expansion of the harboring statutes to criminalize such basic acts of human care, it's really a concerning interpretation of those statutes. It sort of leads to the conclusion that, you know, if you're sitting down at the table with your family member who is undocumented and you know, has a different status than you, do you need to check their papers before you pass them the bread? If you invite a neighbor over for a barbecue, you know, do you need to set up a checkpoint before you can share food or water with
before
them?
Before we end, I wanted to ask Scott, you go on trial today. Amnesty has called for all charges to be dropped. The judges refuse to drop the charges. Your defense today.
Well, we'll be really over the coming week and a half, really outlining our case about the necessity and the need for humanitarian aid and the clear right, morally, ethically, spiritually, and legally, to give and receive humanitarian aid anywhere, and particularly in the borderland region. So
we want to thank you both, but we're going to continue with part two at democracynow.org. Scott Warren on trial today with No More Deaths, and Catherine Gaffney, activist and volunteer with No More Deaths. Thank you so much for joining us from Tucson. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.
All right. Good morning, Savannah. Welcome to the Savannah Business Showcase. I'm your host, Raz. It's not morning anymore. I do that every week. I'm going to just pretend like 11 o'clock is morning from now on. I'm not going to say it. But anyway, good morning, Savannah. Welcome to the Savannah Business Showcase. I'm your host, Raz, and I have a good friend in the studio, Mr. Casey Herrington of Vector Health. And it was Geo Seekers. It was HD Jib. It was Gene. It's been a lot of cool stuff that you've done. So I'm excited to like talk about all of it, but we're also going to talk about AI and a lot of cool stuff today. But we'll figure it out as we go. So Casey, I don't think I asked you this question before. So you walk through your neighborhood, a little kid comes up to you and says, "Casey, you're my hero. I want to be like you when I grow up." Have I asked you this before?
No.
Okay. I want to be like you when I grow up. So in the language that a 10 or 12 year old can understand, what does it take to be Casey Herrington?
That's a great question. Wow. Yeah. You've never asked me that before.
Yeah.
I would say curiosity. Mm. And the desire to pursue those curiosities with like intense focus. I would say that's all there is to it. Like, just, you have to be curious about something, and then you have to have the drive to want to pursue that curiosity.
Yeah.
I think that's all there is, for at least from my perspective, to be like me.
Mm. Mm. So what are you curious about?
Oh man, I'm curious about a lot of things. Way too much that I can pursue. So focus is important, but I'm curious about, you know, how to create intelligent systems,
mm-hmm.
to solve some of the world's biggest problems, specifically in the field of deep neural nets and machine learning. You know, I'm curious about how to impact the lives of patients, specifically Huntington's disease patients, with mm-hmm. the skill set that I have. And yeah, those are some of the curiosities that I'm pursuing right now.
Mm. So you've had so we've known each other for about 3 years now. Mm-hmm. You've had a crazy journey, as have I. And, you know, so like, how do you go from, so for the people out there listening, Casey's probably my first guest. I think he's number one on there. Yeah. Gotta be number one with GLC. Cause you and, I always forget her name.
Porsche.
Yeah. You and Porsche.
Yeah.
At GLC. That was fun. I went to your first office, your original office here over at the high rise downtown. And then, you know, so how do you go from Geo Seekers, which is a kayaking tour adventure company, right, to AI?
Yeah. I guess I should go before GeoSeekers. And right whenever I got out of college, I worked on a startup with a friend of mine called named Andy Capstan. Mm-hmm. And it was a mobile app. And at the time, I didn't have a technical background. Mm-hmm. And neither did Andy. So we worked on this and ultimately didn't turn into anything. And the reason being was that I really don't think that we had like the passion behind the idea.
Yeah.
We were just kind of practicing entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to keep that motivation of practicing entrepreneurship going, but I also wanted to work on something that I really cared about. And at the time, what I was really curious about, what I cared about was doing things outdoors.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, well, let's start something related to that. I live in Savannah. Let's start a company where I'm taking people out on the water. So bought 10 kayaks and, started GeoSeekers and started taking people on tours out on Tybee. And, you know, that was a lot of fun, but it was never going to be a full time.
Mm-hmm.
I was never gonna be able to make the leap with that company. So it was a transition from that business into another project called HD Gym, which was aggregating resources for the Huntington's disease community. And I've always wanted to make an impact in the Huntington's disease community because mm-hmm. it impacted my family.
Mm-hmm.
But it took a while before I could really believe that I could make an impact.
Yeah.
And then once that switch flipped where I believe that, yes, I could do this and I can do this now and I don't have to wait, that's when I started pushing in that direction. And I ultimately started HD Gym, received a little bit of grant funding from a foundation out of DC, and started working on HD Gym full time. And then through the process of HD Gym is when I started to teach myself programming. Because I needed the skills in order to build the platform which HD Gym is on.
Right.
And then that transitioned into building Gene, which was like, it was a lot like HD Gym. It was helping people with Huntington's disease find resources, but it was doing it in a conversational way.
Mm-hmm.
So people can share their frustrations and Gene would connect them with the most appropriate resource. And that's how I really got into AI. Because I mm-hmm. built and rebuilt Gene 3 or 4 different times, and every time I rebuilt it, it got better and better.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what got me hooked. And as I look out on the landscape that is the Huntington's disease landscape, there are a lot of great things happening in research. There are a lot of great things happening in advocacy. And I felt that with the emergence of AI, which is in its infancy, that I could bring this to the table
mm-hmm.
and use this in a helpful way to help everyone across the board in the ecosystem. So that evolved. So we have HD Gym evolved, and then we have incorporate Gene into that as well. And now what I'm doing is transitioning into the company Vector Health, which you mentioned. And that is essentially creating a sustainable platform where we can perform more ambitious AI work for the medical community. I'm mostly zeroed in on Huntington's disease, but what we're building can scale to any provider, like any medical issue.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of where it stands right now, and that's like the evolution of how I got through all those projects.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's a lot of pivoting.
Yeah, for sure.
That's where I'm at now. Personally, it's like I started out as, what did I do? When I first met you, what was I doing then? It was just a radio show.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I didn't know what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
I had a podcast. I was doing a radio show. I had a group of entrepreneurs in Chicago before I moved here that I had grown. I was going to try and restart it here, but that failed miserably. and then I tried. So I did that. And then I went to, after all the radio show interviews I did, I started picking up on a thing where people couldn't get their voice out there enough. So I said, okay, maybe more people need a podcast. So I went straight for podcasting. Nobody here does podcasting, which also means that a lot of people here don't even understand what a podcast is. So I went from podcasting to video because everybody needs video. People understand it. They can see it. But I don't like doing video. Mm-hmm. So I'm pivoting from that now to live streaming, you know,
yeah,
which I love and which people understand. And now I can show people how they can do it and also like make money from it. So I'm thinking this is it.
You're finding that groove.
Yeah, I'm finally finding the groove. But it takes a lot of, I'm doing my hands in like a snake motion now. But it takes a lot of pivoting, you know? It's not a straight line.
No, absolutely for sure. Not. And, you know, I've just been fortunate enough where I've been able to work full time on this stuff for the past 18 months. And that helps a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And knowing that when you are full time on it, knowing that if you don't perform, you know, it all falls apart and you can't really eat, that really motivates.
Yeah.
I think on top of whatever your other motives are.
It does. Or you can have three kids and
that's true. Yeah.
Three kids, two animals, and a wife who's wants more money.
Yeah.
Coming in.
Yeah.
You know, so that motivates as well.
Yeah, we are in two different places on that.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. Same story though. Definitely different
The stakes are much higher.
Yeah.
Definitely much higher.
A little bit. A little bit. Kids got to eat. But yeah. Yeah. So, man, thank you for coming on. Also, I just want to say, man, I appreciate your friendship. You know, we've been friends for a little while now. So, it's rare that you can find a person you can talk to, you know, about anything, have a drink with. And,
yeah, I appreciate you saying
get
that.
Get it off. Yeah. So, for sure. And I appreciate you coming on today, last minute.
I appreciate you having me.
So what does AI... Like, how does that affect business? You know, like business. This is a business show, business owners. Mm-hmm. How is AI going to affect what they do?
So it's going to affect. It's going to affect everything. So the best metaphor that I've heard is that AI is like electricity. Mm. So when electricity was commercialized, it impacted every facet of our lives. It impacts every facet of our lives, and AI is going to be the same way. So for business, it you know, there are a lot of different ways to incorporate AI into what you're doing. So from a customer service standpoint, you can create artificial intelligence intelligent dialogue systems to handle customer inquiries. Mm-hmm. Essentially, like if you have customers who are coming in asking repeated questions, you can create a system that can answer up to 80% of those questions, and then if they can't answer it, they scale it up to a person. So that's just one. Probably the biggest progress that we've seen is in image recognition, but I mean, there's just a plethora of opportunities, I think, for businesses, but it's the understanding and the adoption that I think is going to take time.
So, but that's not like AI is not like a call in, you know, like when you call your credit card and they send you through the automated stuff. That's different.
No, it is different. So like, you can create programs that, you know, I don't want to call them dumb programs, but essentially the system that I'm talking about is it's a dialogue system. So the way that it would work is you would have two neural networks trained on different data. The first neural network is trained on conversational data. And that would be what would be called in the machine learning and the AI field is natural language understanding. So when the string or the sentence, whatever the person says, comes in, it's picked up by that network and it determines what the user's goal is.
Mm-hmm.
And then it passes that to the other network. And the other network is trained on what's called story data. And then that network predicts what is the next best action that it should take.
Yeah.
So that's much more of a robust and intelligent system rather than like a decision tree.
Okay.
That you would see in a typical program.
Gotcha. So you said you call it like a neural network.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That makes sense. So more like a web instead of, like you said, like a tree.
Yeah.
Kind of.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. Nice. So, I mean, a neural network essentially is, think about it like a function, right? So it takes in an input and it produces an output.
Mm-hmm.
But it's, it's literally a function within a function within a function, depending on how many layers it has.
Mm-hmm.
And the way a machine actually learns is that the information is passed through that network. And imagine, if you've never seen a neural network displayed visually, what you would see is you would see a layer of nodes, and every layer is connected by a, it almost looks like a web, right? Mm-hmm. So every layer is, every node is connected by, is connected, right?
Yeah.
And those connections are weights and biases that connect each layer. So when you pass the information through, the neural network makes a prediction, and the prediction's typically wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a cost function at the end, and then that determines what information to pass back. So now the information is being passed back. And all those weights and biases, all those connections that connect those nodes, they're adjusted ever so slightly to create a neural network that is able to make a correct prediction.
Gotcha.
So that's quote unquote how a network learns.
Okay. Okay. So it's more, it's very dynamic, you know, versus, you know, it's very dynamic and very multi-layered versus just, you know, one layer of answer this, you know, do this.
Yeah.
Okay, I got you. I got you. Okay. So because I get it, but you know what I'm saying? You don't really get it.
Right.
So like I can see where, you know, I can see the, you know, videos on YouTube of AI and, you know, these heads talking to people, but like, you don't really get what's going on in there. It just looks like a trick.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's a bunch of layers. Okay. I got you. And that seems hard. So clearly like, so vector health, clearly you think it's going to impact the health industry and the medical industry pretty big.
Yeah, that's the plan. Okay. So right now we're focused on patient engagement, but more specifically helping clinics with a problem that they have. And that's that physicians on an annual basis, they lose about $150,000 from patients not showing up to their appointments. And it's not just bad for the physician, right? They lose a lot of money, but it's also bad for the patient, because if the patient misses an appointment, the probability of complications increases dramatically. So we've created a deep neural network that can make predictions on whether patients are going to show up for their appointments or not.
Mm-hmm.
So the clinic will essentially put in some patient information, and then it'll tell them this patient has an X probability of not showing up for their next appointment, and then recommendations they should take to get that patient in.
Yeah. So would that take, no matter like which city you go to or which city you're in or where you live, like the hospital, the medical system is like the biggest employer. Would this take away jobs from those employers, or like how do you alleviate that stress that they're going to be losing jobs or have to fire people for this, you know, adding AI to the system?
Yeah, no, job displacement is a big deal. But in this case, there's no displacement as far as with this, this thing that we're working on, because the tools that we try to build and try to implement are things that humans just can't currently do. And being able to make certain predictions are just kind of, you know, they're not taking away somebody's job, at least not right now. I think that as this progresses, job displacement is going to be a big problem. But I also believe that our imagination for our ability to imagine what the future jobs will look like is very limited. So I kind of go back and forth on whether job displacement is going to be a big issue or not. But you know, I'm up for the conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. That's awesome, man. Cause that's, you know, it's just one thing I think about, like, again, it's not AI, it's just a machine. But if AI is like machines or computers on the next level, you know, how is that going to affect the world?
So like when we achieve our true artificial intelligence?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's going to be monumental.
Yeah.
Because, and they call that, they have a name for that. They call it the singularity.
Mm.
And they call it that just because it's so monumental that, and it will change so much so fast, we can't see past it. We can't predict what is going to happen after that point because it's going to change things so fast.
Mm.
That's kind of scary to think about.
Yeah.
And I honestly, you know, people say that it's 50 years away. Some people say that it's 5 years away.
Really?
Yeah. I honestly, I don't think it's 5 years away. I think the prediction that I'm kind of leaning towards is they say 2029.
Mm.
I can see that. I can see it being here by then. And, you know, there's a lot of work going into AI safety and trying to create systems that we can control.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I think we're foolish to think that we're going to be able to control it.
Yeah.
But I also think that it is inevitable. Like we're on that trajectory.
Mm-hmm.
And no one's going to stop AI research.
Yeah.
It's going to continue to happen. This is like, it's a competition between countries at this point, honestly, yeah. who can achieve true AI faster. So, I mean, it's going to happen. It's just a matter of when.
Do you think that like humans are just AI that God created? And he got a left us after we got out of hand. completely red. I'm just, you know how I think, man.
Yeah,
like, right. So you don't have to answer that. But like, do you think, do you subscribe to any of the big conspiracies around AI? Of like, was it like Deus Ex Machina or anything crazy like that, where like the machine is going to take over?
I mean, that's a tough question to ask. I would say that I think that there is a probability. It's the probability of that happening is not zero. So, but how likely is it to happen? You know, it's hard to say with certainty. I just hope that the good people outnumber the bad, and when those days come,
yeah,
because you know that's ultimately what it's going to be. It's going to be humans creating AI for malicious purposes.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah,
I think that if we democratize AI and spread it amongst the masses, where everybody understands it and everybody knows how to build it, then we'll be in a much better place for the good people to outnumber the bad people.
Mm. How do we do that?
So I think it's happening right now.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, so if you go, I mean, Khan Academy, if you go on YouTube I mean, there's the School of AI. I mean, there's just literally free resources for you to go online and teach yourself about all this stuff.
Really?
Like, if you just have the time, you go online, you can learn. You can literally get a state-of-the-art education, you know, in this field just with free online resources. Mm. So, I mean, I think it's happening. It's just a matter of, like, who's going to take interest. And I think that a lot of people are taking interest. Which is good because what we want.
All this stuff, it's like over my head, but I'm extremely interested in it, you know, because it is the future.
Yeah, and absolutely.
I'm thinking about other industries. I'm thinking about the, you know, my industry that I'm in, the media and marketing and video and live streaming and, you know, how is AI going to affect that? And how can I, you know what I mean?
Oh, for sure. Have you heard about the deep fake videos?
Yeah. I just saw those the other day. It's crazy.
Yeah.
You see the one where like they did a quick transition, like Arnold Schwarzenegger's face on that one dude who was doing an impression. it's freaky.
Yeah. And they're only going to get better.
Yeah.
Like we're still in the infancy of this. Mm-hmm. Like it's going to get better. And, you know, that opens up a whole box of, you know, what information can we trust and what information can't we trust, right? Mm-hmm. We thought this previous election cycle with, you know, having social media ads like fabricated targeted to us, you know, was tough and it was manipulating. But imagine AI that can really create video that is indistinguishable from other videos of something that never happened.
Right.
Like it's.
Right.
It's crazy.
It is crazy. Like just. Yeah, it's extremely crazy. It could be like, you know, Trump again in office, but he's made to look like Obama. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, it's limitless. I mean, we're literally going to have to start educating people
mm-hmm.
on how to filter out information.
Yeah.
Or people are just going to shut down and not listen to anything and not trust anyone.
That's where we are now.
Yeah.
That's where we are now. Most people don't trust anybody.
Yeah.
And they don't know who to, you know, and then so then they only trust the people they agree with, but they're lying to them too. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, that's why we have like leftists and far right activists and people who just don't leave the party. And as soon as they hear something that's not party specific, yeah. you know, agreeable to the party, whether it's whatever topic it is, mm-hmm. you know, then they feel this deep hate, yeah. you know, whether you're on the left or you're on the right, you just hate the other side.
Yeah.
And that blows my mind.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I listen to far left stuff and I listen to far right stuff just so I can kind of come up with my own opinion.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, I think that if we, I think it's only going to get worse, like that division,
mm-hmm.
if we're not proactive about That's changing right. it, like it's not just going to fix itself.
That's right. Yeah. And it's stupid. You know?
Yeah.
It's stupid. Yeah. Like people like hating fathers and sons hating each other, you know, brothers and sisters hating, can't have dinner together because of what you believe in, you know, yeah. political wise. It's just stupid.
It really is.
Yeah. Yeah. So that blows my mind. And you're right. It's hard to trust. So like once like these deep fake videos, get better, or once, you know, once all this stuff is indistinguishable to the common eye, like how do you tell the difference? Who do you trust?
Yeah, that's going to be tough. Like, I think we'll see a cultural shift from consuming content, digital content, to consuming non-digital content. I mean, that seems like a reasonable assumption to make,
yeah.
because if people can't trust, you know, this fake, I mean, I don't want to say fake news, this fake content,
mm-hmm.
Then they're going to, I mean, they want to get that information, but they want to get it from something that they trust and that's right. something that they know can't be manipulated.
Yeah.
So that's either going to be from non-digital content or it's going to be from, well, I guess people are also non-digital content. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think we'll see that shift. How long it'll last, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's just so hard.
Yeah.
It's so hard. I was talking to local news station. I want to help them like create a podcast or a live stream or a video series where they help build their trust back up by like helping to record, you know, some of their reporters on who are actually going out and doing the work and, you know, looking up the sources and, you know, just showing all the work they put into the article that they write.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the only way is to like show the work.
Yeah.
You know, because otherwise it's like, why should I trust you if you just say that? I can just say the opposite thing and have just as much conviction. So yeah. it's like you have to show the work you put in. Yeah. Otherwise you can't build that trust back up. And it's hard. It's hard work, but it takes time. Because you can't just trust the news anymore. You can't just trust. I don't know. This is just something I think about. I was about to get deep into it.
Yeah.
But like, but yeah. But I think about that a lot because I'm about to buy a green screen. And at that point, how do you trust me? Maybe I'm not even right. in the studio now. You know, yeah. maybe I'm, you know, I get a green screen suit. And maybe I'm naked. But that's just really, I look like I have a suit on. Yeah. So it's completely. It's incredible, but it's also, like you said, scary.
Mm-hmm.
All right, cool. So we're going to take a short break. Casey, how can people find you?
You can check out hgym.org, and my information is on the about. Or you can just find me on LinkedIn. Casey, Herrington, Herrington.
Cool. All right, guys, we'll be right back. I might put Casey through the lightning round. We've done it before, but we'll see. Let me pull the questions up and see we'll figure it out. All right, but don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with more from Casey Herrington of Vector Health and me, Raz, with the Savannah Business Showcase. Thanks for listening. We'll be right back in a second.
WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are Savannah Soundings, community radio with global soul.
Thank you to our listeners and the readers of Connect Savannah for participating in the 2019 Best of Savannah poll. With your help, WRUU has been selected as the best local radio station and the best local talk radio station in Savannah. Thank you, Savannah, for listening and voting and supporting community radio.
Support for this portion of WRUU's programming comes from Clark Creative, a visual design studio in Savannah, providing brand acceleration, market materials, and website development to area businesses, organizations, and startups since 2004. For more information, visit clarkcreativedesign.com.
Tonight on WRUU, tune in at 7 for It's a Big, Bad, Beautiful Noise, alternative rock and electronica. At 8, The Blues Hour features all styles of the blues. At 9, Music Local and Sustainable is all about Savannah-based musicians with interviews and features. At 10, Theme Stream dives into a weekly musical theme. And at 11, Mink Mink's Alphabetical Hour brings you alphabetically arranged songs. Our latest schedule is always at WRUU.org. And thanks for listening.
The University of Georgia's Skidaway Institute of Oceanography will present a talk featuring Rick Van Noy, author of Sudden Spring, Stories of Adaptation in a Climate Changed South, on Friday, May 31st at 7 p.m. at the Skidaway Campus Library. For more information, call 912-598-2325 or visit skio.uga.edu.
How many times have you heard WRUU's corporate underwriting message? If you remember it, then your potential customers will remember your message as well. We are offering this space to connect corporate and institutional partners with our loyal and active listeners. Underwriting on WRUU is short, so listeners don't tune out. It's exclusive, so your message won't be lost in advertising clutter. And it supports Savannah's only community radio station. For a marketing package to increase your reach beyond traditional media, email underwriting at WRUU.org.
WRUULP, Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are Savannah Soundings, community radio with global soul.
All right, Savannah, welcome back to the Savannah Business Showcase. I'm your host, Raz, and I'm here once again with Mr. Casey Herrington, local, Coastal Georgia local, but he is also like the Tony Stark of Coastal Georgia, you know. So he's like, all right, man, I'm going to get you a suit. I'm actually going to introduce you to, I probably told you about it before, but they're the Astrals. I had them all before, but they're like a group of volunteers, and what they do is they help, they're kind of like the middleman, right? So if there's a crime, you don't necessarily want to report to the police. They'll help you investigate it. Yeah. So if something's stolen, you don't feel like reporting it, or you know, you can anonymously report it to them. Yeah. So you get an Iron Man suit, you can be an Astral.
Yeah, I think we had this conversation before. Isn't there like a Batman somewhere in this story?
Yeah, his name is Knight.
Okay.
Knight, yeah. Yeah, he's a cool guy. We talk. Awesome. Yeah. We talk a little bit every now and then. I tell him I could be his be the Peter Parker. Yeah, it's just nice. Yeah. So I try to help shout him out every now because I think it's a cool idea.
Yeah.
You know, it's something new, something different, and I think they're actually helping people. So
yeah, I've kept an eye out. I haven't seen anything though.
Yeah, they have like a bat signal. Well, it's like an astral signal now. So they somewhere they have a huge light that like projects into the sky with like the astral symbol on it.
Really?
Yeah. Like how cool is that?
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah. But back to you, back to Vector Hill. So like normally I do a lightning round around this time and ask a few questions. We've done one before, but that was 3 years ago. So I'll probably ask you a few of the same questions. So what did you want to be as a kid and how does it relate to what you're doing now?
Oh man. So as a kid, I wanted to impact the Huntington's disease community. I guess as a kid, you know, I thought about, you know, my family's impacted by this disease and I have, you know, X number of years to try to make a difference. And I was extremely confident as a child that I would make an impact in some way.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, that's kind of manifested itself over the past 18 months with the work that I've done
mm-hmm.
with HDGEM. And, you know, with that work, I've been able to travel and speak at Huntington's disease conferences around the United States. And I think that, you know, I'm on that path,
mm-hmm.
which is incredibly exciting.
Yeah. Yeah. So I feel like I'm on the path too, but like, do you have a timeline or are you just kind of going day by day?
So I do have timelines, but it's nothing that is set in stone. I think the best way to explain it is that I have this vision of what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how long it's going to take me to get there. I know that I'll get there, right? If not, I know that I'm pushing the ball in that direction, right? And people are benefiting along the way. So I'm patient for that to manifest, but I'm impatient on the day-to-day. So I'm trying to move as fast as I can day-to-day,
yeah.
but I'm incredibly patient for the long-term vision to manifest.
Mm. What's the long-term vision?
A world without Huntington's disease.
Mm. That's a great one. And you got mm-hmm. it. I think you can do it. I don't know my long-term vision yet. I know I want to make an impact somehow. The more I think about it, like I want to do something for the troops, mm-hmm. you know, for the people who protect the country.
Yeah.
I didn't think about going. My mom was always like, no, you're not going to the army. So I was like, okay. And I was like,
okay.
Yeah. You know, I'm short and fat anyway, so I probably wouldn't have made it. Well, I guess slow, short and slow. But I definitely want to be able to like give it. I also heard like Deion Sanders say that, which is random, right? Because he said, you know, he was one of the greatest players ever in multiple sports, but he wishes he could have played in the Olympics or played and like served his country with his, mm-hmm. with his talent somehow.
Yeah.
And I kind of feel the same way.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm trying to figure that out as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's a good direction though.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. I'm heading that way. I haven't figured it out yet, but I'm working on it. How have you, I know I asked you this before, but I want to hear it again. How have you approached failure in life?
You know, I don't really see anything I do as particular as a failure in any way. Mm. A failure to me would be knowing what I need to do and knowing what I want to do and not doing it.
Mm.
That would be a failure to me. And I haven't necessarily done that yet. But I have, you know, tried to do things and they didn't work out the way I thought they would work out.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, some people might consider that as failure. I don't. I consider everything I've done just an evolution to get to where I am now.
Yeah.
And there's going to be, you know, there's going to be much more evolving. But as long as I, you know, just stay true and, do what I believe is necessary and mm-hmm. I'm heading in the direction that I know I should be heading in,
mm-hmm.
there is no failure. You know, even like I said, if that vision that I have of a world without Huntington's disease doesn't fully manifest, all of my effort is still pushing the ball in that direction.
Mm. Yeah, I like that. As long as you're doing what you know you should be doing, it's not a failure.
Yeah.
The opposite of that is not doing what you know you should be doing. That's a failure.
Yeah. I mean, wouldn't that just eat at you?
Yeah.
You know, like, you know that there, you know that in the back of your mind, like when you look yourself in the mirror, you know you're not doing what you really want to do and mm-hmm. what you really know you need to do.
Yeah.
And you're at that point, you're living a fake life and you're not doing, you know, you're not doing the world any good. I don't want to say the world. I'll say you're not doing yourself any favors by ignoring, right, what it is you truly want to do and mm-hmm. the value that you want to bring to the world.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. Let's go to the next one. If you could live anywhere in the world, where would you live? I've probably asked you this before, but I know that's changed.
Oh, man. Let's think. New Zealand.
You said New Zealand last time.
Yeah. I mean, it's a good spot.
Okay.
You know, they've got Mount Cook.
Have you been before?
Beaches. I haven't, no.
Okay.
I think it would be awesome to climb Mount Cook.
Yeah.
And I'll probably eventually get over there. But, that's probably number one on the list.
I met a guy from New Zealand once. When I lived in Chicago, I was a hustler up there, and I was like a handyman for a little bit. he ended up playing for like, he was a New Zealand professional rugby player. So he mm-hmm. played for like the All Blacks.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I can't remember his name or who he was, but like, he had me come over to help him like replace a light. It was a chandelier, and like I had to wire it, and like we had to get it back up in there. But you know, I brought a few tools, like wiring tools.
Yeah.
Again, I'm like 22, 23 at the time. So like, we're there like standing on this table, on a chair, trying to reach the chandelier. And we're both like, he's just a little bit taller than me. So we're like both like barely getting up there. It was like a crazy situation to thinking about now. And it was like a brick wall. So yeah, we had to like have a really crazy, like an impact drill. And I only had like a basic drill to get into the brick wall.
Oh yeah.
So like, I'm sorry, complete sidetrack. But he was a nice guy, and he told me about New Zealand and how nice it was,
and how they call everyone Kiwis.
Yeah. You should definitely go, man. Make a trip. Plan a trip over there.
Yeah, I want to. I'm gonna give myself a few years before I start putting any more pressure on the New Zealand trip.
advice for young kids. Early teens, right? Advice for early teens who want to start a business.
Read a lot. I would say read a lot. Read as much as you can. And let the reading don't let it just be random reading. Let it be tailored to whatever it is you're pursuing.
Mm-hmm.
I think if you're starting anything, the key to getting results is finishing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, you know, read a lot of books, stay focused, and finish.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. My motto with books is that I'll pick a book up, and if I get something from it in the first six pages, then that's all I need, and I'll close it and I'll just go do it, you know?
Yeah.
Like if I really get something from it, then it can be in the first six pages and I don't have to read anything else for a while. I'll pick it back up later.
Yeah.
But I don't feel like I have to read the entire book.
Yeah. I think that's a misconception that if in order to read a book, you have to read it from cover to cover.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's necessarily the point. The point of a book is you want to gain insight, you want to gain motivation, you want to learn. So, I mean, there have been times where I've picked up a book, looked at the table of contents, saw two or three chapters that I really needed to know,
mm-hmm.
read those two or three chapters, and that was it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that. Because you're not going to be tested on it.
No,
you know
what
I'm saying? It's not school anymore.
Yeah.
There's no quizzes.
Yeah, you're not reading to please anyone else. You're reading for your own benefit.
That's right. That's right. And I think that's something that a lot of people don't do. And sometimes I get away from it. Sometimes I read a lot. I have like six audiobooks in my queue right now that I gotta that I've been listening to a little bit at a time. But sometimes I get away from it, and every time I notice that I stop reading for a little while, if it's been 3 months and I haven't read a book, then I just get like in a funk, you know. Mm-hmm. I get in like a space where I'm not progressing, or I don't feel like I'm progressing. I don't feel confident about what I'm doing.
Yeah, that's so interesting how that works.
Yeah, it is. There's definitely power in reading.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And sometimes it's better to read a great book 100 times than to read 100 good books. once, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I can see that for sure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's, I don't know if you watch Game of Thrones, but Tyrion had a quote in that. It was probably like season one. And he was like, it was a whetstone to a sword, which is a whetstone. It's like it sharpens the sword.
Mm-hmm.
A whetstone to a sword is what a book is to a mind.
Mm.
So it sharpens the mind.
Mm. I do like that.
That stuck out to me.
Yeah. So. That's been years ago since I've seen season one, but yeah. I liked it a lot. That was like pre-Scar Tyrion.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. What'd you think about the final season?
Oh man. Yeah. The best episode was probably the battle against the Night King.
Mm-hmm.
That was the best episode.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like it was rushed. I felt that it could have ended better.
Yeah.
And I feel like they were trying to please two things. I felt like they were trying to please the audience too much. And I also felt like they were trying to make the ending too unpredictable.
Yeah.
You know, it's okay if the ending, if someone guessed the ending, you know, it's all right, but make it just awesome.
Yeah.
Like even if they know that so-and-so is going to be on the Iron Throne, they guessed it, that's fine. But how they get there, like that's really tough to guess. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. I thought it could have been, but
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. It definitely could have been way better. I actually like really enjoyed everything, all of them, like just from a storytelling standpoint. The cinematography was amazing in most of the episodes. The acting was still really good. So I enjoyed each episode separately for what it was.
Yeah.
It's just, but that last episode, man, just made me mad, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's kind of a happy ending.
Yeah, I heard.
And Game of Thrones should not have a happy ending. Oh, no. Like, everybody should be dead.
You know, and that was my prediction. Everyone was going to die.
Yeah.
But the writers, I heard, held up in, like, I don't know, some cabin or somewhere off the grid. And, like, they turned off their phones and turned off everything while the final episode was happening.
Yeah.
So that they could avoid the backlash that they knew was going to ensue.
Yeah. And I get it. Like, they were just tired. Like, you can't do that for the rest of your life. Like, all the actors want to move on.
Oh, yeah.
The writers want to move on. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I get it. But, come on. But anyway. Yeah, man. So I guess we'll get ready to wrap up. I usually ask one final question. But before I ask that question, once again, people can reach you how? What's the best way?
You can reach me at casey@hdgem.org. That's hdgem.org.
Got you. So if you guys have questions about AI, if you have questions about Huntington's disease, if you have questions about starting a business just here in Savannah, you can probably reach out to Casey. He has an answer for you. He knows somebody who does.
Yeah, Casey, happy to help.
Yeah, Casey HDGem. Yeah, so final question, and then we'll go ahead and close it out. If you had a superpower or ability, what would you choose and why?
I would say to consume information 100 times faster or 1,000 times faster.
Mm.
Yeah. And for obvious reasons, just that's incredibly powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what I would say to that is that, like, be careful, like, consuming too much. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Why do you say that?
Because it could slow you down. You can get like paralysis by it. I know you don't all the time. Like you take action. You're a man of action. But like you can get the paralysis by analysis and you think you don't know enough and you think you don't have enough, you know, but you do.
Yeah.
You know, you got it. I've seen the books you've read. You got it. You know what I mean? So,
yeah, that's true. That's a good point.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway, thank you guys out there for listening. We're going to start live streaming these shows with video and audio and graphics and cool people and cool angles. So I'm working on that now. You can go ahead and check it out at the Savannah Business Showcase YouTube channel. Today was just a graphic, but thank you guys for tuning in. Or you can check it out on SBSWRUU on Facebook. So thank you guys for listening. As always, be the change you want to see in the world. If you want to change the world, you don't have to have $1 billion. You can just go down the road and tell somebody you love them. So as always, I love you guys, and I will see you next week. Peace.
WRUULP Savannah, Georgia, 107.5 FM, WRUU.org. We are we'll be right back.